As an economist, I think that the Bitcoin price rollercoaster has been one of the most interesting monetary experiments of this century. Well, last time the price went up like this, it was clearly a bubble. But this time, I think it might be different, and here's why. What might be surprising is that economists have not really found a reliable way to indicate whether we are actually in a bubble or not. The reason for this is that no one knows the true price of an asset, and the first economist who figures out a foolproof way to do it will stop being an economist immediately and become a trader instead. That being said, for a behavioral economist like me, one of the clearest signs of a bubble is the presence of what Nobel Prize winner Robert Shiller calls irrational exuberance, meaning most people are really, really enthusiastic about the price of an asset, and the general sentiment is that it will only go up. In 2017, there was clearly irrational exuberance in the Bitcoin market. A telltale sign of this was that most of my friends, who were never into finance, economics, or investing, all of a sudden could talk about nothing else but Bitcoin investing. What's more, they all seemed to make fortunes. It was an interesting experience, to say the least. Even though I knew it was a bubble, it was really difficult emotionally, even for me, not to jump in. This must have been the case for many, many people. Indeed, many of my friends acknowledged that I made solid arguments when saying that it was a bubble, and yet they still kept investing anyway. The dopamine shot of numbers going up seemed bigger than their rational sense, knowing that it was a bubble. I suspect fear of missing out was also a very big factor. Then, when the bubble popped, most of my friends sold way too late, turning a massive profits into massive losses. Embarrassingly, it was only at this point that it started to feel good that I hadn't bought into the bubble, but rather stuck with my training in economics. In my mind, this validates the importance of behavioral finance. Behavioral finance, in contrast to the previously popular efficient market hypothesis, basically assumes that while markets are often efficient, they are sometimes captured by an exuberant period. This exuberance is irrational because the price of a financial asset will be pushed far above what it really should be. That's when there is a bubble. So the last time, Bitcoin was clearly a bubble because of the presence of irrational exuberance. Similar to how the 2006 housing market was clearly a bubble. To see what I mean, check out the Florida scene in the Big Short movie.
200% on all my loans?
What do you mean all your loans? We're talking about two loans on one house, right?
I have five houses and a condo.
Hey, there's a bubble.
Importantly, in behavioral finance, if prices have risen really quickly, that doesn't mean that we are in a bubble. After all, there could be a fundamental reason for why these prices have risen so much. For example, it could be the case that the central bank has purchased many assets, driving the fundamental price up by making financial assets scarcer. Now, what does that mean for Bitcoin? Even though at the moment of recording, the Bitcoin price is at an all-time high, there is quite a bit of optimism, but also quite a bit of pessimism. Nothing we can really call irrational exuberance. It seems more likely that the most famous cryptocurrency has matured to a proper financial asset. All major asset prices are at an all-time high, especially considering that we are in a massive economic crisis. So, does that mean that the Bitcoin price will not crash again or will only go up? To be honest, I really don't know. If I truly could predict asset prices, I wouldn't be making YouTube videos now, would I? Remember that when you next see someone on YouTube claiming to know exactly where the market is heading. I do know that I am not buying in because I don't fully understand where the value of Bitcoin comes from. Is it mostly used as a financial hedge like gold? Or is it increasingly used in illicit transactions? Or perhaps to avoid capital controls? What do you think? Let me know in the comments. Also, if you like this video, consider subscribing to the channel, which is all about monetary economics, finance, and macroeconomics.